my success is not for me. My success is from God.
You knew I was wearing a wig.
I didn't know.
I am wearing a wig also.
Created by women for women.
I would never go back to my smartphone. It's not hard for me.
Worrying will kill you quicker than the virus will. Right.
They will not be on a camera with me. No way.
No, they won't.
Exactly.
We believe strongly that we're not in our own hands. I've seen someone that understands music the way she does.
What would be the biggest thing you think you need to fix? That's the only thing I knew about the Hasidic world was unorthodox. Do you believe you're a free person?
We hide things under the rug because we're afraid.
Follow the rules.
I follow the rules.
Okay. We all had it. My family had it. I had it. It was like a hard flu.
Good morning, guys. For most of us, the Hasidic Jewish world is a very mysterious place, especially the female side of it. So today we have the good fortune to meet up with a local Hasidic woman who wants to talk about her life, tell us about her views on the world, and, well, see wherever the conversation leads us. Should be an interesting one. Malky, Peter.
Namaste.
Okay.
We don't shake hands.
You don't shake hands because of COVID.
Yes, not because of COVID. We don't shake hands because we don't have any physical contact with men outside of our husbands.
Is this okay? This space?
Yeah. It's not. Okay. It's not so much about space. It's just about keeping physical contact down to nothing.
Let's go this way.
Okay, fine.
So, you're not what I expected.
Right. I'm not.
You're Hasidic, right?
Yes, I am Hasidic. I'm not. You could say I'm not your stereotypical Hasidic woman.
You grew up Hasidic, right?
Yes, I grew up Hasidic.
I am married. Hasidic. Kids.
I'm married Hasidic guy.
Okay.
And my kids are being raised Hasidic.
Okay.
I'm a filmmaker.
What kind of films?
So, my movies are not typical in that they are catered special for our community. So, mm-hmm. they have no violence.
Okay.
No bad language.
Okay.
No romance, no sex.
Okay.
Boring! No, I'm kidding. Really beautiful, beautiful human topics that we touch on.
Is it accepted by most people?
Yes.
In the community?
Yes. It's absolutely accepted because I am providing entertainment for them. I'm providing kosher entertainment and they need it badly. I have 7 kids and I don't want them to see things that aren't okay.
Okay.
I'm careful what they watch.
Okay.
And there are very few things that they can see that are kosher. So I'm happy that I can create content for our community. There are many, we don't have TVs at home.
Mm-hmm.
So no TV, I don't have a computer at home.
Really?
No computer at home. My only internet access is on my phone,
uh-huh.
and that's locked. Nobody gets to open it. If anybody needs to order something, I order it for them. As an Orthodox woman, you know, there are certain levels of modesty. Modesty isn't just clothes that you're wearing to cover yourself. Modesty
right.
is also how out there are you?
Mm-hmm.
Can you sing and dance in front of men?
Yeah.
And so, you know, the people that perform on my films are women who don't want to be performing for anybody else but women.
Okay.
So my DVDs will say on them, for women only.
Honestly, this is a foreign world to me up until about a month ago.
Right.
And I'm still an outsider. I don't know anything, just the little videos that I've done. I didn't expect that someone could be like you, I guess. So open, creative, running their own businesses,
mm-hmm.
that sort of thing. How is that received for the most part?
Right.
I'm sure the very, very conservative would be against it probably.
Right.
And then are there just all different levels
right.
in
so
a casino?
Yes, there are different levels within Orthodoxy, there are different levels, and within Hasidism, there are different levels.
Right.
Yeah, kids do need structure. They crave it. It's like that with people. It's nice to have some of the guesswork taken out, you know?
Mm-hmm.
When you're given some rules, and of course, it's not. Too many rules isn't good for anybody, and not everybody does well with it. So we have community rules that are kind of like unspoken guidelines.
Okay. Okay.
And we have rules that are in our Torah.
Uh-huh.
That we adhere to. If ever rules are getting too much for me, I say, wait, stop. There's community rules and there's Torah rules. There's Torah.
Uh-huh.
I want to stick to that first.
Okay.
I'll either ask a rabbi if I'm not sure. But if it's a community guideline and it's just too hard for me, like leopard print is not okay. Let's say I'm just making it up. I don't know. I'm covered.
Speaking of, you have the leopard print shoes, which
yes.
are very styly. The
yes.
shirt, and that's okay.
It's okay. You know, but like I said, there's many different levels. There are many women in my community that wouldn't wear leopard
okay.
print, even though we can play with style. We can have fun with style.
Mm-hmm.
I can wear lots of great clothes.
And
I
makeup? Never... Makeup is okay?
Makeup is okay, but no, some people will believe that makeup should be just natural. It shouldn't
okay.
be too colorful or
sure.
too unnatural. We can look pretty. We're supposed to look pretty. We're supposed to look good. We're supposed to feel good about ourselves. It's just that we're not supposed to look provocative.
Gotcha.
Feel safe in this neighborhood because this is a safe neighborhood. Anybody that lives in this neighborhood that's not Jewish
uh-huh.
is happy to be here.
Really? I could live here, no problem?
Of course you could live here.
Okay.
Of course you could live here. You would love it here. There's no crime. There's no violence.
Okay, as a Hasidic woman, when you observe, say, non-Hasidics, mm-hmm. say actually non-religious people in America, mm-hmm. do you think they're missing on something? Like, I'm not a very religious person.
Right.
Right? I was growing up, brought up Protestant, but I don't practice now.
Right.
Are people missing something, do you think?
So I believe that everybody should try to pick up some religion, some spirituality in their
uh-huh.
lives. I believe so strongly that it doesn't matter what religion we're talking about.
Right.
Anything that you can connect to.
Uh-huh.
That teaches you that there's more than what you see, more than what meets the eye. There's more. Our world is so much more than just the tangible.
Mm-hmm.
And understanding that there is a higher power and that there's somebody that's helping you.
Yeah.
And that's there for you. I believe we would have less anxiety. We would have less depression. I think we would have less suicide. People.
There's a lot of anxiety right now. Do you feel that?
Of course, there's
maybe
anxiety
not in this neighborhood, but
in this neighborhood not so much. But there's anxiety.
Because you guys for the most part aren't so scared of COVID. Most people have had COVID, right?
Right? So
you've been
COVID.
Through it, right?
Yeah, sure. We
okay.
all had it. My family had it. I had it. It was like a hard flu. It was hard,
mm-hmm.
but it was just like a flu. So I personally believe that if you're a healthy person,
okay.
you don't have anything to worry about. Worrying will kill you quicker than the virus will.
Okay.
Anxiety is killing more people than the virus is. So,
yeah, it's tough to put a number on all these byproducts of the virus too.
Yes,
like
right,
an economic
right.
number or, you know, how much does stress kill someone, you know, hurt someone's health.
Right, right.
It's nice to be around Hasidic Jews right now who are not all paranoid.
Right.
It's really, and here's some crazy irony. If you have the average, say, secular, progressive American, they're a million times more fearful to get together with their family right now than the supposed most conservative, repressed people who are out in the open having a good time. How crazy is that?
I believe it's because... This is my personal belief. I
yep.
don't take this from anywhere. I just feel strongly that it's because they believe that it's all in their power what is happening to them. Meaning, everything that you do
okay.
is going to determine the outcome if you will or won't get COVID. So, whereas we believe that it's important for us to do what we have to do to protect ourselves within normal boundaries.
Mm-hmm.
And we believe in doctors and we believe in medicine and we believe in all that because God said you have to do your due diligence.
Okay.
And if you don't, then that's negligence and that's not okay.
Okay.
But once you've done your due diligence, we believe strongly that we're not in our own hands.
Yeah.
Even if you did all the right things and God wants you dead, you'll still die.
Right.
So when you have thrown that up to God and you're not carrying that around, that responsibility, that you are responsible for your own life. It's such a strong responsibility, it can weigh you down. You are responsible to make sure that you don't get COVID. Are you doing enough? Are you separate? Are you keeping away from people? Are you wearing enough masks? Maybe you should wear 2 masks, 3 masks. Are you washing your hands enough? That can wear somebody down. I don't know how people live like that. But knowing that you did the best that you could.
Right.
And within normal means, and then the rest. And I strongly believe it's because we believe that God's taking care of us.
Yeah.
And it's His decision, not us, if we're going to die from COVID or not.
Do you believe you're a free person?
Of course I'm a free person. And that reminds me, today's Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
I'm very thankful to America.
Yeah.
I love America.
Yeah.
I think this is the best country in the world. I have such strong love towards this country.
Yeah.
For allowing us to live freely and be who we want to be.
Right.
So I know that wasn't your question. Your question was,
yeah,
do you believe you're a free person? In regards to what? In regards to...
Well, freedom's such an ambiguous word. You can say, like, you know, freedom is only, you know, your mind space, or it could be your external conditions. You sort of answered that with America. America loves you to be who you want to be.
I love America.
With the least amount of resistance. Especially
yes.
A place like New York.
Yes.
There are all right. Walks of life here. Everyone's here. Everyone's doing their own thing.
Absolutely.
You can't be judged for it.
And just like every community
yeah.
has its negative things
yes.
inside them, I still believe with our, you know, justice system a big mess, with our election system a mess, with our presidents a mess, mm-hmm. all of them,
yeah.
all the presidents.
Yeah.
The whole thing is a mess. I still believe that America is the greatest country in the world.
Yeah.
Where else do we have the freedom to be who we want to be and to do who we want, do what we want to do? We don't have that anywhere else. So I still believe it's that same concept that every community is beautiful
mm-hmm.
and it has its down things. Like, you know, I'm not going to say our community doesn't have things. You know, we hide things under the rug because we're afraid.
Mm-hmm.
We, you know, like, there are things in my community that bother me and I'd love to change, and I'm trying to help change things
okay.
in our community that need it. But our community is a beautiful community. I wish people could see that and know that. Just like America is a great country, even though
yeah.
we're a big mess right now.
But all the media, just like Hasidim, all the media about America is pretty negative.
Yes.
And all the media about Hasidim is pretty negative. You don't understand America until you get out. I mean, I didn't. Until I got out of it for a while. And now being back here, oh my God, I'm doing exactly what I want to do in life. You're doing exactly what you want to do in life. Without anyone judging me or telling me I can't, or restricting me, or making it super difficult.
Yeah.
And when that goes away, America loses what's great about it.
Yes.
But it's still here.
It's still here. It's a mess.
And the mentality is here for that.
Yes, yes, it is.
And that's freedom, in my opinion.
Yes, absolutely.
Is to be able to manifest whatever your divine purpose is, right?
Absolutely.
It channels
that,
through you.
I believe that strongly.
And so much of societies restrict that. And you as a Hasidic woman don't feel that restriction.
I don't. I understand why some people feel it.
Yeah.
And I understand why some people believe that we are restricted.
Uh-huh.
But this is something that I really want to say. Someone recommended a book
mm-hmm.
about a Muslim woman.
Okay.
Actually, a woman who married a Muslim guy, she fell in love with him and he took her back to her country. I don't remember where it was. I read this a few years ago.
Okay.
And I read the book and it portrayed the Muslim community really badly.
Mm-hmm.
At the end of the book, I was thinking, like what I had heard, Muslim women are repressed. Muslim women can't leave their house. They can't do anything. They can't. And then I stopped myself. You see, I talked to myself. I said, Malki, no. Don't do that. You're doing what you don't want everybody else to do. You're judging a whole Muslim community by reading one book.
Right, right.
You read one book. This is one person's story, and it could be a true story.
Yes.
But you don't know anything about the Muslim community until you don't go in there.
Yep.
Until you don't meet Muslim women and get to know them and get to see the
exactly.
beauty of their community. You cannot make no assumptions that this is the Muslim community and these are Muslim women and they're
yeah.
repressed and they're and that the men beat the women and all the rest of that. It's not okay. So I stopped myself. Now I'm still waiting to make a Muslim friend. So 13th Avenue is, we walked here so that you could meet 13th Avenue. This is a very, very Orthodox block where the women do their shopping here. It's like, you know, Fifth Avenue of Manhattan.
Yeah, I've been here. I came here with Shlomi.
All right, so you've been here, right?
Okay, so audience, any Muslim woman out there in the New York area?
I'd love to meet a Muslim woman that can take me into her community and show me the beauty of her community so that I don't think what I heard about one Muslim woman. I read one book.
Right.
And I know that the community is beautiful. I know, I believe their community is beautiful.
I've been to many, many Muslim countries, and I found them to be the most hospitable people.
Really?
Cultures, in general.
Wow.
And your culture so far has been very hospitable to me.
Right.
It has this image of being very hard. But once you go under that, it's very open. Okay, but to your point, I want to mention this apartment building. Check this out, Melky.
Okay, what do you
see that? Okay, so that apartment, and sorry for whomever lives here, it's just an example. I'm not saying this is your life. You know, someone could be getting, you know, abused in that apartment.
That's true.
Someone could just have gotten married in that apartment.
Correct.
Someone just had a kid there.
Okay.
Someone is dying and they're old.
Oh.
Someone is madly in love, making love. The point is, those are all true stories. They all exist at the same time. And I think what you're saying back there is what you learned about the Muslim community is you saw one story. That's one story in the apartment. In the Hasidic community, like unorthodox, that's the only thing I knew about the Hasidic world was unorthodox. And if you just watch that story, it's definitely not your story, right? It's the apartment. That's one story. Is it true? I didn't do the fact check, but I'm sure it is. I'm sure it's a true, someone's true story.
Right.
And so what the problem we have is we all get caught in our worlds of saying, okay, this is a label. Here's a story, attached story, label. Done, easy, black and white, simple.
Kosher clothing?
Kosher clothing?
Kosher clothing.
Let's do it.
We have our stores that cater to what we need, which is we need to cover our elbows, we need to cover our neckline, and we need to cover our knees.
Okay, so all the skirts go below the knees.
So the skirts have to cover the knees. So not in all communities, of course, but in my community, this is... This is a big deal. We have our knees covered, we have our elbows covered, and we have our neckline covered. Other than that, we can do whatever we want. We can wear whatever we want. We can have fun with our clothes. We can, you know. But then there are people that take it a little extra, and they will be careful with even the colors of their clothing.
Okay.
Also, a big deal is it shouldn't be too tight. Shouldn't be too form-fitted, you know.
Sure.
So everybody has their levels.
Okay, here we have the latest greatest Hasidim fashion.
A friend of mine works here at the counter, so I'm going to introduce you to her. So this is Hindi.
Okay.
A good friend of mine.
Hi.
Hello, Hindi.
Hindi was acted in one of my movies once when I needed a part.
Yes, I did when I was.
Yeah, that's
you're a retired actress?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
Many different colors and, you know, lots of variety. Lots of variety. So, if I wanted to buy tops, I can go to Zara. Zara sometimes even has skirts that are long enough for me to wear. I'm going to let Hindi do this because she's going to do
this
better.
Sure.
Not 23 inches or 22 inches. It has to be like 25, 27. Like it has to cover.
Sure.
Don't look at me, but it has to cover.
She's a bit more mod.
I'm more, yeah.
But the boots are not modest. Those
no,
are stylish.
Not modest. She's a bit more mod.
Oh, modern. Oh, gotcha.
But she's more out there, and she's
I am
not
modest,
your typical Hasidic woman.
I'm not Hasidic.
You're
not Hasidic.
No,
I never.
You're Orthodox? Ultra Orthodox?
Orthodox.
Plain.
You follow the rules.
Jewish, I follow the rules. Whatever.
You follow
it is,
the rules.
Yeah.
Okay.
But I look more modern. So.
Yeah. Gotcha. Yeah.
Sorry.
No problem.
Tada rabba.
You speak in Yiddish?
I speak in Hebrew.
You're Hebrew. Okay.
Yes.
But do you speak Yiddish too?
No, I speak very few words. My kids speak Yiddish.
Ah.
My kids went to a Hasidic school.
So where are you from? The States originally?
No, I'm from Israel. I have two girls. Like. yeah, they went to a Hasidic schools, but they are more modern. Okay. They wear long wigs and.
Oh, question. I have a son who is not religious. Is everyone wearing a wig?
Yes.
I have a son who is not. I have a son who
is
not.
You knew I was wearing a wig.
I didn't know.
I am wearing a wig also, but it's very like.
I am too. Swear to God. No, let's. I would love to talk about that on the street, actually.
Hey,
if there are any wig shops, too.
Oh, sure.
So there's a wig shop, actually, that you would like.
This is Rachelea, and Rachelea does all the music for my movies. She does all the recording. She's a brilliant, brilliant artist. I've never seen someone that understands music the way she does. Brilliant. I don't go to anybody else. She is my person. So, here you have a Hasidic woman that has a family, four children. How many kids?
Four kids.
Yeah, four kids, and she does what she loves.
I love music since I'm probably 5 years old. I give out like a few songs a day.
You make a few songs a day?
So,
yeah. I have a recording studio in my basement.
Okay.
My husband built it for me.
Okay.
And I think it's beautiful for people to know that the women in our community, if they want to do something, they do it. And they can still be in the community, and they can still be live the sheltered lives that they want to lead, and they can still be fulfilled, and they can still raise families and still do what they love. And I can introduce you to so many women.
The phone you're texting on, not smartphone, right?
BlackBerry.
So no internet, no distractions all day long?
No, but I do have internet in my studio.
Okay.
You know, sometimes I need to email songs, sometimes I need to research a tune, find the things, the chords of it. You know, on YouTube, I'll do that a lot, so
Do you feel like you're missing out not having all these apps on your phone?
I don't. I actually used to have a smartphone.
Okay.
I had an iPhone, and just because that's what I got, because I was a music girl, so I had an iPhone right when it came out. And then when I started having children, I realized how much it distracted me, and especially being that, like, with my musician mind, how I got, you know, it's very hard to, like, be on the phone and be fully in something, and then also be with your kids. So I was like, no, this is not going to work, you know? So I sort of got rid of the smartphone.
Was it like removing a bad drug habit or something, the smartphone?
No, it's actually the best thing in the world.
No, I'm saying it's like removing a terrible substance from your life or something.
Was it hard for you to do it?
It was hard for me. I needed people to tell me, you'll be okay, you're doing this for your children. I needed the support.
Oh, really?
Yes, I did.
Wow. I would like to get to that.
Anything else, and then I couldn't decide if a BlackBerry was kosher enough, because I need a BlackBerry just because I text people all the time, and I'm always texting my customers.
Yeah.
And that's very important for me. And at a certain point, I was like, I need a smartphone because this is my business. And then I realized, no, there's another way. There's a BlackBerry that's not really considered a smartphone, and like I could text them, have everything I need, and I don't need to be sending videos of my kids in the park and then emailing them. That's not quality of life.
That's not quality of life.
It's not.
I would like to get to that. Seriously.
You should try it.
I deleted a lot of my apps. I have no notifications.
Wow.
It's a process. But you're totally right. Like, society is you have something that most people don't, which is clarity. And that takes away from clarity. I mean, this takes away from clarity, my phone.
Actually, the reason, the thing that got me to that was sort of like a spiritual mentor.
He or she helped you along with that, or what?
The spiritual mentor, she used to be in my studio a lot, and that it started out that she went to call a car service, and she asked me to cook. She didn't want to use my phone. I said, why? She said, oh, because I don't touch smartphones. It's like I made myself like a
boundary.
And I was like, what? What's wrong with it? I didn't know what was wrong with it. Now there's an awareness, but at that point, I remember thinking, she's crazy, what's wrong with it? If I could afford it, why can't I have it? It was very expensive, I don't know if you remember, when it came out, it was like...
Well, yeah,
once
okay.
you make that decision, that you don't want a smartphone, you have to keep the discipline so that you can get your
back. I would never go back to my smartphone. It's not hard for me. It would be hard for me to go back to my smartphone.
Like, I stopped drinking 5 years ago, and I can't imagine having, I think it would be the worst thing on the planet. You couldn't force me.
No, and I think maybe it would be the worst thing feeling. To have an iPhone. It's horrible.
The worst thing to have an iPhone.
Yeah. And even my texting, it's so hard for me because
the
customers are texting me, and I also want to, like, give my kids supper, but I also want to answer the text, so it's hard.
It's a competition for your attention.
Exactly.
And your kids need to win.
Exactly. You got it.
All right. Thank you. You're great. You're all great.
Hate
will hurt you more than will hurt the people that you're directing it at. And that's because hate eats you up from the inside. It's a negative emotion that isn't good to have. So if anybody is hateful, I feel bad for them. I see people that are hateful and I'm thinking, wow, I only feel bad for them. I really only feel bad for them because it's not a way to live. Okay, here's a kid's clothing store. Should we go in real quick?
No, let's do the
the
music, and you were talking about the wig store.
Oh, the wig store. So let's see the wig store also.
Okay, so tell us about wig culture. Every woman wears a wig?
So we wear wigs because we're supposed to cover our heads once we're married. We cover our hair.
Okay.
Our hair is reserved for our husbands.
Uh-huh.
And we keep it covered when we're outside. Some people choose to cover it with a kerchief. Some people choose to cover it with pretty hats. And some people choose to cover it with a wig. There are some people, like in the very, very, very Hasidic, Orthodox Hasidic sect of Satmar, that believe that women shouldn't be wearing wigs, they should just wear kerchiefs. And that's why if you've been to Williamsburg, you notice that the women all wear kerchiefs. They're not wearing wigs. And then there are many different levels, just like there are many different levels of many different things, there's also different levels of wigs. And if I wanted to be a good girl and work on my modesty, it might be one of the things that I would do. I would cut it a little shorter. I actually cut this one. Come here, let's check out my music store. Come here.
Okay.
Come here, real quick.
This is your video.
No, you don't understand. I'm seeing it for the first time in the store.
Oh, wow. Fantastic.
Nice!
What's the theme?
I'm just so excited. Okay, so this is my only movie that's a true story about 8 girls who were in a home in Sweden after World War II. They were left with no family, their families were wiped out, and how they learned to live again. So I recreated that time era. It's my most expensive movie because it's a time piece. And I needed to create costumes, and I'm very proud of it, and it's in the stores. This one, my first movie, my second one, my third one, my fourth one.
So you've done 5 now.
Yeah, so all these are created by women for women. And it'll say on it, if you look close, for women and girls. Do you want to get close?
Okay. So
you see, it says for women and girls.
Men cannot buy this.
Well,
one of these.
Well, there's no policeman standing here and saying that if they can or can't. But they, you know, we do our part to make sure that men shouldn't see it, and it only gets sold in stores where people are religious and we trust that only women are going to buy it.
Great. So there's a full-on cinema film scene here.
Yeah. Here, these are hers. These are my friends. All these are my friends.
She does slapstick comedy.
My sister did slapstick comedy.
You guys have a good sense of humor, I've noticed.
Well, we
for the most part.
And we believe that that's the way to live. It helps.
That's a Hasidic principle, right?
Yes.
Happiness and fun.
Exactly. You need to be happy. You need to be enjoying life. Live. Just live and enjoy it.
So do you feel your community lives and enjoys, like, can express that, can live that?
For sure. For sure. It's a big principle. Not only that, we have songs that talk about how important it is to be happy. Happiness is something that you create on your own. It comes from inside you. If you decide you want to be happy, you'll be happy. I know many people who are walking around happy and they have reason to be miserable. Uh-huh. I know many people who are miserable. And
it's a personal decision, really.
Right. So that's what I believe strongly.
Wait, how do you define happiness?
Happiness is a contentment from inside. I feel like it's just a oneness with yourself, and feeling whole.
Does your work bring you to happiness? Does it help? I'm sure family does.
Yes, working, doing what I love, makes me feel like I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing down here on this world. I can't be feeling any better. There's no greater feeling in the world than knowing your purpose. You know that.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. It took me a long time to find it.
Yes. And once you find it, you're like, oh, now I know
then
what I'm here for.
Then you can go without sleep and feel fine about it.
Yes, okay. Yes. Right.
Because if you go without sleep doing something yet you hate, life is miserable.
Yes, that's true. Oh, that's what you meant. Yes, that's true.
Like, I can grind hard and not get much sleep, but as long as I'm doing what I love.
Absolutely. That's why they say if you love what you do,
you didn't work a day in your life.
Yeah.
Right?
I just found it in my 40s.
Wow.
Took me a while.
Yeah. It's okay for me to feel the pride, but I know where it's coming from. I know that my success is not for me. My success is from God, who has helped me to be successful by giving me the talents that he's given me to help me do what I love. Yeah. If it makes you feel alive, you need to be doing that. That is what you were created to do. If it's not making you feel alive, stop. Stop. You can't live like that.
Which way?
I think where we need to go is that way. Yeah, I think it's that way. So let's go this way. Hi, Rahalaya.
This community is very wealthy in wisdom, in culture. In the beauty of simplicity, I would say. That's what I feel here. The beauty of simplicity. Yeah. Like the woman who's a sound designer for you, talking about getting rid of her iPhone and spending more time with her kids. Yeah. I think that's, look, I don't have it in me yet to be there. But I admire it.
I don't have it in me yet to be there either. I have a smartphone.
But I look at it at, honestly, in the world we're in right now, I look at it as someone that's like pushed up a level of enlightenment, if they can get to that level where they don't have to be distracted, where they can focus their attention easier on the more important things.
Right.
This is easy. This is pure dopamine. It's a little drug.
It is. Right? It is. It absolutely is. I know this because I sometimes find myself aimlessly reaching for my phone to look at it. I don't even realize that I'm doing it. It's like, and then I'm upset at myself. Well, what are you doing? What? Where are you going?
That's something the world can learn from the Hasidic community, the modern world, right?
Right.
Like, it's pretty obvious our phones aren't helping. You know, if you're doing the aimless staring, it's not making your life better.
This is my whole connection to the outside world. Other than that, I'm living in a cave, in a very cozy cave.
You call this neighborhood a cave?
Borough
Heights. Or what? We're in Borough
Park.
Borough Park, yes.
Okay.
Crown Heights, Borough
Park. It's a cave. It's a very comfortable, cozy cave where things are short and that we are able to stay insular and stay insulated even in such an you know, metropolis of, you know, totally different culture than ours.
Yeah. So one theme I've heard come up time and time again is many in the Hasidic community don't like the cameras in here because typically it means that something negative is going to happen, right? Some negative slant, some angle. Why do you think that is? What's the reasoning behind that? Of course there are bad stories, there are bad things that happen in every community.
Right.
And we've seen a lot of those, but people are scared to be on camera with me a lot of times because they're like, what are my intentions?
Right.
Am I gonna show how, you know, behind or uneducated or whatever it might be?
Exactly. That is exactly, you just said it.
Okay.
Basically, our community has seen way too much negative exposure about our community. And so, you know, nobody's being too eager to, you know, to speak openly to the cameras.
Mm-hmm.
I had a professor once asked me, a professor at School of Visual Arts.
Mm-hmm.
He asked me, why is it that your community doesn't care what the world thinks about them? Why is it that they don't want to be open to speaking to people?
Uh-huh.
I said, we do, but and no matter what we do, no matter what we say, it'll always be misconstrued and turned around. We feel like people that want to hate will hate. And we're just very, very wary of media exposure.
It's an abusive relationship, right? Do you want to go back
right.
for more abuse?
Exactly.
Gotcha.
So I feel that the reason I'm comfortable with speaking to the camera is because I feel like it is important for people to know that if you've seen or heard anything about the community that was negative,
mm-hmm.
it's possible that that is true and it exists, but
yeah.
it's not okay to classify the whole community
right
as a whole, and that is what the community is.
It's an easy, cheap label.
Right.
It's, if you don't want to think, you can do that, I guess.
Right.
But it's, the sad thing is major news outlets, that's their prerogative too. And these are supposedly educated people running these.
Right.
Well, I didn't know. I think of Hasidim. You know, Hasidic Jews are Hasidic Jews, like one label, right? That's, they are like this, they dress like this, they think like this. And you're showing me that, okay, there are different levels, spectrums within that category.
Absolutely.
And so you're doing your filmmaking, you're living the life you are, you're dressing the way you are. There are some that won't be doing this. They'll be much more conservative.
Right.
They will not be on a camera with me. No,
no
way.
No, they won't.
They're not going to be walking around
no,
with a man.
No.
I respect all of that. I'm not here to judge and tell what's right or what's wrong. But I think the audience should know, again, the theme I always say, it's way more complicated and full of gray zone than a black and white existence.
Exactly.
Even in this subgroup of Judaism, there are many subgroups within that.
Absolutely. Just like in any other community, we have our ups and downs, and we have things that we need to fix, and we have things that are beautiful, and we have things that...
What would be the biggest thing you think you need to fix? You can take it any way you want.
But. Yeah, okay. I'll take that. So, I feel like a lot of things that our community is afraid to talk about and afraid to discuss, that the community itself needs to fix for the community. They
okay.
don't have to fix it for the whole world.
Gotcha.
They just have to fix it for the community because they're so busy hiding it that people aren't getting help.
Okay.
So I love to, with my films, I like to always open up a topic that is a little sticky or not spoken about, and use that as a way to change things in the community. Let's talk about it.
Like a physically challenged woman marrying, right?
Exactly.
That's one of your big themes?
Yes. So,
and having a kid.
Absolutely. And the movie that I'm doing now is about a woman that's suffering from anxiety and depression, and she's not getting help because she doesn't want anyone to know about it.
Okay.
It's important maybe not to broadcast it to the whole world.
Mm-hmm.
I get that.
Yeah.
But still, if you're not going to get help, that's not what God wants. Our community is very careful about, you know, not saying a lot of things because they're afraid of what people will think. There's a lot of stigmas in the community that
mm-hmm.
need to be broken
mm-hmm.
within the community. I'm not
okay.
talking about what the rest of the world thinks about us. That's one topic of discussion. Talking about in the community itself,
mm-hmm.
people are a lot afraid to do certain things that are okay to do. It's just not accepted in the community because
right.
of what will the community think about that. And it's okay, except for when it then can cause harm. I feel like we just need to open discussion. Let's talk about things. Let's
mm-hmm.
open discussion.